What's the scale of this agreement, Fabi? How many units did you agree with the FAA, and what does this represent for your tech?
Thanks a lot for having me here. Yeah, right now, FAA is having two units to evaluate the technology. So we are building them since 2016, formerly known as VRM Switzerland. And basically, the whole trick is that we are improving the visual projection by using VR headset. I mean, traditional flight simulators, full flight simulators are using dome projection, and they are actually missing the 3D perception. And with virtual reality, the whole thing gets improved. So based on that, we also make it possible for pilots fly close to the ground. In addition, it is enabling the visual 360 degrees around full panoramic view. And because we're using VR headset instead of those gigantic dome projection, the whole thing gets smaller. And we can move it much more dynamic, improving the fidelity level of the entire full motion simulator with full-blown cockpit and all possible things.
Fabi, how much does a single system cost, the headset and the cockpit rig?
Yeah, so it's with motion, and it's basically replacing the traditional simulators, which is around 20 times cheaper than what was there before. That allows us to provide at much more spaces training to make it available to address the pilot shortage, and kind of like a really nice possibility because it's a much smaller footprint.
Caroline, what's so interesting about this technology is it's already certified in Europe by the European regulator. In the US, this is not full certification.
And to that point, Fabi, how many of you therefore sold in Europe already? Is it something that you've seen a marked shift, a faster pace of rollout?
Yeah, definitely. So last year we've qualified 13 units in Europe, because in Europe we have to qualify each single device. And it's really taking off. Now pilots are doing training, and not only training, but also checking on those units. And it's going up more and more, kind of like really taking off. And now expanding to US, I mean, we are really happy that FAA is also looking in at new technology, so that you can pave the way to qualify that as well and make this available in US.
Taking off, a few puns going on there, Fabi. I'm interested in, well, what and how are they taking off? Is this all about helicopters? I'm immediately thinking about the new areas of technology, the fact that we'll be having, well, vertical takeoff at some point, we hope.
You're spot on. I mean, the reason we went first for the helicopter is there was a need in the market because, I mean, there are a lot of safety issues. I mean, many things you cannot do on a real helicopter, and there were simply no units available to train in a realistic manner. So this is kind of like one reason. The second reason is the helicopter is way far more difficult to simulate. So we've taken this as the higher benchmark, and now going also into the fixed wing market as well. Perfect mixture, the eVTOLs AAM, where we also have the technology now ready, which is in Europe already qualified.
Fabi, what is the technological advantage or superiority of your headset relative to what Meta is doing with the Quest or even Apple with the Vision Pro?
It's a very good question, Ed. So the thing is, I mean, at the end, we are not building our own headset. The key thing is kind of like to use what's there on the market. The challenge is to qualify it. Because, you know, having a headset on, you don't see your hands. How do you operate the cockpit? So we had to do very, very special technology there. How can you prove to the authority, to the aviation authority, that everything is still without any geometric distortion and so on? So there is a lot of work and a lot of details to be done that at the end, the pilot can make use of the full immersion plus feels like in a real aircraft.
Okay, so who is building the headset for you?
Basically, we are quite a headset agnostic right now. We are using the Vario headset. It is the one having the resolution which is required from an authority point of view, with our own modified IG that we basically can meet the regulation specification. So from that point of view, it is just kind of like, let's say, a visual device we are using there, but with the advantage of having the three-dimensional view, and then combining with a lot of technology that a person sees him or herself as a pilot doing the operation, finding the buttons, touch screens, and can operate them.
I want to understand just supply-demand dynamics here at the moment, Fabi. How much are your headsets really needed at this moment? How much are we seeing? We know that there's strike action among pilots. We know that there's an issue in terms of supply side. Can you rectify that?
Let me quickly talk to very specific narrow market where we are right now, already started. So every helicopter pilot has to do all 6 months an operational proficiency check, which has been normally done on the real aircraft. Very dangerous doing malfunctions and so on. So actually one-third, 20% to one-third of the accidents are happening whilst doing training and checking. So that's now all moved completely to the simulator. So it's per pilot, which is already having the license. It is 2 to 4 hours per year, then doing additional safety training. So it's kind of like about 8 hours per pilot. That's one very, very small area. Then in basic training, like in US for the airliner training, there are 1,500 hours which needs to be done. So up to 100 hours already now can be done on a simulator type.
Of course, simulations and all this technology, Ed, it costs money, right?
Yeah, it costs money. And I guess, Fabi, the next question is, do you need to raise more money soon to fund your growth?
Right now, we are in a very, very good position that we already have customers, and we can't easily get further customers, so a good natural growth is there. Nevertheless, depending on how fast it's now taking off in US, we will need to scale as fast as we can. So we look forward how we get through that journey.